can make it on Saturday, Sunday, be there on Sunday.
What's that?
Jim. Oh, it's just Jim Kelly saying that he'll be here next Sunday.
Jim Kelly's coming over here. Jim Kelly, from the class of 83, the quarterback for the Bills.
Yeah.
Give me that.
Yeah. It's personal. This is personal. Yeah. Titles. Give me.
Welcome to American Football on Channel 4.
So he is coming.
He is coming. We'll talk about that later on. And more news about the Texas Home Care Super Bowl competition. But first, tonight's game, the AFC Wild Card game between the Houston Oilers and the Seattle Seahawks.
Well, since the Jets finished last in the AFC.
Yes, they did. Yes, they finished last.
I've been plumping for the Seattle Seahawks.
Oh, watch out, Seattle.
Didn't do them any good in their last game of the season, though, because they lost to Kansas 41-20, and that meant they lost the home field advantage in the Wild Card game. So they'll be playing at the Astrodome tonight. And they also lost Kurt Warner in that game with an injury, which means that Craig will probably go to Largent, who used to be a Houston player.
That's right.
And, of course, there's the Boz at the back.
Yeah. Oilers have got to watch out for the Boz. But I actually fancy the Oilers. I mean, this is their first winning season since 1980, and they've got 5 number one draft picks in the offence. That's not even mentioning...
Warren Moon.
Warren Moon, the quarterback, that's right.
Of course.
I forgot his name then, Warren Moon, yeah. Well, also, they're very, very aggressive on the field, as, you know, people have said.
Yeah, Chuck Noll was a bit upset with the aggression on the field.
Yeah, but I reckon it's going to favour them against the Seahawks. Well, now let's go over to the game, which is at the Astrodome.
Only committed Texans expected to see the Oilers in the playoffs, but here they are in front of their own fans to take on the Seahawks. Seattle are without their injured Kurt Warner and so have an inexperienced running back pairing of John L. Williams and rookie Tony Burse. The Oilers are led by Warren Moon, who's largely responsible for Houston's recent successes. Our commentators are Joe Namath and first, Marv Albert.
For the Houston Oilers, it is their first playoff appearance since the Bum Phillips regime. They last hosted a playoff game in December of 1979. They last made it to the playoffs in 1980. The end of the era of Love You Blue. Earl Campbell was midway through his Houston career, but since the days of Campbell and Phillips, they have come up empty here in Houston, Texas. Sellout crowd of 50,594. We have heard some noise here in the early moments, of course, during the introduction of the Houston Oilers lineup. And it's Alan Pinkett returning the kick from Norm Johnson. Houston won the toss. And they will go to the offense as we get underway in this AFC wild card game. Warren Moon, a 50% passer. 21 touchdowns, intercepted 18 times with Mike Rozier and the rookie Alonzo Highsmith. And he has outstanding receivers. We'll see for good portions of the ball game. 4 wideouts utilized, a massive offensive line. The center is Jay Pennison, a second-year man from Nicholls State. And it's a first down for Houston from the 21-yard line. And they go to the ground for Rozier. Rozier, who last week ran for 103 yards on 20 carries, picked up 6 on the play. As a look at the Seahawks defensive alignment, Jacob Green is headed to the Pro Bowl, although there are many who say it's not one of his better years despite that status. The rookie Brian Bosworth inside with Fred Young, who has been the best Seattle defensive player. Melvin Jenkins starting at left corner with Terry Keller bothered by a sprained ankle. It's a second down and 4. The tight end Williams in motion. And it's Highsmith. And he has the first down. Alonzo Highsmith, who has been brought along slowly following his holdout, did not suit up to play until November the 8th. Had a good one last week, his best game as a pro. Fred Young made the stop, and Houston with the first down from their 32.
Well, here you see Brian Bosworth, 55, trying to take on the all-pro guard, number 63, Munchak, and Munchak certainly got the better end of that battle.
Smith and Rozier working at the eye. Boone throws for the first time, going deep for Gibbons. And it is intercepted. Intercepted by Jenkins. Now, Joe, the feeling was that the Oilers would go right at Melvin Jenkins, who has replaced the regular Terry Taylor. And Jenkins picked it off in front of the intended receiver, Ernest Gibbons.
Well, they went right after him, but he was in excellent position. Now, if this ball is a little bit farther out front, you may have a completion, or at least Gibbons can break the pass up. But when you look where this ball is, it's underthrown, and Jenkins adjusts to the ball better than Gibbons, you see. Had the ball been out front, it might have worked, but give Jenkins credit on that coverage.
Jenkins, a first-year player from Cincinnati, with his fourth intercept of the season, and Seattle first down from their 46. The quarterback, Dave Craig, and the running backs, John L. Williams and Tony Burks. And that's Williams with a short pickup. The inside linebacker, John Grimsley, combining with nose tackle, Doug Smith. There's John L. Williams, first-round draft pick last year. Tony Burse, a rookie from Middle Tennessee, the other starter. And Steve Largent is the man as far as the Seahawks are concerned. The deep threat is Darryl Turner. We'll see quite a bit of him later on. Grant Fiesel, the new name of that offensive alignment, with Blair Bush out after breaking a hand earlier in the year. Second down and nine. And Craig going deep for Largent. He's got him. And a first down and much more. Keith Bostic, the strong safety on the stop of Steve Largent.
Couldn't have been done any better. Excellent pass protection by the line of Seattle. Craig sets up, has the time, he's comfortable back there, and he just throws a beautiful pass. Largent downfield, made the inside move and got the jump on the defender. Watch where this ball comes down. Right there, just in the pocket. Beautiful pass.
33-yard pass play. Who last week caught six, became the NFL's all-time leader in pass receptions, setting the first down at the Houston 20. Largent 80 in motion. Big rush. Craig gets it away for Largent. Inside the 10, and Largent goes over for the touchdown. Good block by Ray Butler, the wide receiver. On the other side, he went 20 yards for the score, and the Seahawks take a 6-0 lead.
So many ways Largent could beat a team. The man blocks well. He runs well after the catch. Here, Craig setting up the pass to the right. Fools the Houston defense. Wow, what a move he made getting away from Doug Smith. Now, 54 right there. Fiesel, the center for the Seahawks, made an excellent block, and the rest of it's Largent. And number 70, Big Mattis down there to tackle for the Seahawks, throws another good block.
Three plays, 54 yards for the score. And here is Norm Johnson, who has been perfect this season, and he continues the perfection. 41 for 41. The Seahawks strike early, and they lead Houston 7-0.
So yet another Steve Largent catch opens the scoring for Seattle. But Houston's reply is developing nicely. They've reached their own 38, where it's 2nd and 6.
Off the swing, it is Rozier. Some very nifty open field running. Melvin Jenkins, number 24, made the stop. And Rozier with a 7-yard gain and another. Houston, first down.
Well, they set up the screen to the right side, and we'll see number 63, Munchak, and 74, Matthews, get out there to give Rozier some blocking. The defender's overrunning. Now, watch this. He cuts right back there. That's all Rozier again.
Nice head fake on the right defensive end, Jeff Bryant. And a first down for Houston from their 46-yard line. Seahawks 7, Houston nothing. Rozier out to midfield. Picked up 5. Strong safety Ken Easley on the stop. Last week, Jerry Glanville, the Houston coach, felt it was the best run-blocking performance of the season by the Oilers' offensive line, and they're off to the good start here in the first quarter.
Except June Jones told me, the quarterback coach of the Oilers, that they must be patient offensively. That first series with the long interception didn't show much patience at all. This series is.
second and six. Moon got the time, and a nice leaping catch by Drew Hill in front of Patrick Hunter. 15-yard pass play, and that gets the crowd going.
Drew Hill with speed to burn on the top of your screen is covered by 23 Patrick Hunter. Now, Hunter will give him a good cushion. Hill just stops and turns back inside and makes a terrific catch. That ball, this ball is hard to handle. The blocking is there. The Moon is so strong, he puts some heat on this pass, and that's all hands there, so a fine catch that time.
Drew Hill had 49 catches this season, six last week against Cincinnati, although he dropped a couple. One in the end zone. First down from the 35. Rozier inside the 30, and the Oilers are mixing up the play calling. Bruce Schultz, the outside linebacker, made the tackle on Rozier.
But hey, it seems to be the offensive line of the Oilers are controlling things out there. Here they get off the ball well, and Rozier cuts it back. But you know, most of these football games are won and lost at the line of scrimmage. And in this drive, it looks like Houston is establishing the dominance.
And that is a massive Houston order front line. Second down and four. Inside the 30. Highsmith could not find a hole. Short pickup for Alonzo Highsmith. Outside linebacker Greg Gaines, who is back in the starting lineup, combining with the Boz, Brian Bosworth.
Interesting to me that Bosworth has to call the defensive signals for these Seahawks. You know, he's a rookie, and the young man has so many things going through his mind out there as a rookie. He's not that experienced, yet he's burdened with having to call the defensive signals. People say that he hasn't been playing up to expectation. Hey, I can't see how he could.
And some intimidating words from Brian Bosworth as Warren Moon looks at a 10th play of this drive. Third down and two. Rozier tried to change directions but could not, and the Seahawks able to hold the Oilers. Fred Young was right there.
Draw play here, fools Bosworth, actually comes clean through here, thinks it's going to be a pass, but Rozier goes the other way. Freddie Young, number 50, comes in to make the play along with Jacob Green, 79.
Brian Bosworth, the man with the most recognizable mohawk since the French and Indian War. 46-yard field goal attempt for Tony Zendejas. And it is good. Tony Zendejas, in his third year from Nevada Reno, has had an excellent season. Zendejas putting up three on the board, and with 4:44 remaining in this first quarter, it's the Seahawks 7, the Oilers 3.
So the Oilers on the board. And on Seattle's next drive, Dave Craig lost his footing on the AstroTurf on third down, and the Seahawks were forced to punt. Then, as the quarter came to an end, Warren Moon moved Houston into Seattle territory with this 15-yard hookup with Drew Hill. So now, at the start of the second quarter, Houston have a chance to go ahead.
As we resume with the second quarter getting underway, the Oilers have a second and three down at the 4-yard line. Seattle 7 and Houston 3, a 20-yard touchdown pass from Craig to Largent that was preceded by a 33-yard pass play. A good look from the goal line at Warren Moon. And his kicker driving. And no indication as of yet. He is just short of the goal line. Alan Pinkett, who had a 22-yard run last week against Cincinnati, the longest of his career, able to move it to the goal line.
Pinkett gets help from number 32, Alonzo Highsmith, at 63. Munchak, I had a good talk with Mike Hollaback, the player personnel man of the Oilers this last week, and he says Pinkett would be starting for most other teams around the league. Here we see another angle of Pinkett running through a huge hole there. Robinson, number 41, saved the touchdown for the Seahawks.
was out with a shoulder injury earlier this season. Here's a first down, so a first goal from the one. Quarterback sneak. Pete Butler on the stop. And the Oilers were stopped short.
I don't know if Moon wants to try this anymore today. He takes a good lick from the linebackers in here. You know, there's a general philosophy when you have a tough kind of coach, a guy that likes to play that smashing football, that you should be able to make that half a yard anytime with the quarterback. But hey, this is the NFL. You have to give defense credit now and then. They're big and strong, and they can stuff that quarterback sneak.
What they call smash mouth football. Second and goal from the one. Now he gives it up to Rozier. Change of direction. And he is in. Houston has taken a 9-7 lead. A beautiful block by the right tackle, Dean Steinkuhler.
How sweet it is. It sure is for these Houston Oilers fans. Not much to say about that last play other than Steinkuhler's block and a wonderful effort by Rozier.
Now, Tony Tendejas, Jeff Gossett, the holder. And it's 45 in, second quarter. And the Oilers have taken a 10-7 lead on the Seahawks.
Mike Rozier, a former Heisman Trophy winner, has struggled to produce his college form in the NFL. But this season, his confidence has soared, and this brilliantly improvised touchdown certainly shows that. However, the Seahawks believed he was the beneficiary of an illegal block on the play. It looked suspiciously like a clip. But all their protestations did them no good, and now the Oilers have the ball again. With 10 minutes remaining in the half, it's third and four at their own 46.
And the Oilers go with the four wide receivers. Going with the short set and completes. What hands? Ernest Gibbons stopped by Brian Bosworth. So the catch by Gibbons is second of the day.
Just a terrific catch. Gibbons goes straight downfield and crosses the middle. You'll see him coming from the right side to the left side of the screen. And watch how he stretches out here. Gets, oh, what a good catch. All hands. Bosworth makes sure that he's down, of course.
Picked up 13 on the play. Houston Oilers have won their last two. Three out of the last four. The one loss over that stretch at New Orleans. 24-10. Down at the 40.
Goal!
And off the swing, Pinkett. 3-yard gain. Eugene Robinson, the free safety, combining with Brian Bosworth on the stop.
Now, Bosworth does have excellent speed. I was told yesterday that the Seahawks have clocked him in a 40-yard sprint in 4.5 seconds. You know, that's a little bit faster than Steve Largent. But Bosworth's problem this season has been adjusting to the pro-type offenses. It's been said he's taking the blockers on with the wrong shoulders. I think he has a lot to think about out there, and he's going to be an outstanding linebacker.
Second down and seven at the Seattle 37. Moon got the time. Highsmith out of the backfield for five, so short. On the first down, Greg Gaines, the outside linebacker. On the stop there, Gaines making his first start in 3 weeks, followed by a strained knee. Tony Woods, the rookie from the University of Pittsburgh, had been in the starting lineup. Houston now looking at a third down and one at the Seattle 31. Houston 10, Seattle 7 in the AFC Wild Card matchup. 7:45 remaining in the first half. Let's see. It was recovered. Alan Pinkett on the fumble covered by Brian Bosworth.
I don't know why the fumble occurred. I can't quite see it here. The ball hits him pretty good in the midsection, but it looked as though it bounced away from his rib cage. Maybe the ball wasn't quite far enough in the old bread basket. It kind of hits him on the side and a little bit up high here. Reaching for the ball. You know, running backs aren't supposed to reach for the ball.
And a field goal attempt for Zendejas from 49 yards away. Earlier hit from 47. He's 21 for 27 on the season. Again from long range. He does it. ...49-yard field goal, and Houston leads Seattle 13-7.
Tony Zendejas's two field goals the difference between the teams at the moment, but now with 4 minutes left in the half, Jeff Gossett is in to punt for Houston, and Bobby Joe Edmonds is deep to return.
Keep an eye on the outside man, Patrick Hunter. Sam Merriman, number 51, who comes from the middle, also very effective. And let's see how they play it. Here they come, and Neely picked it off. A return by Bobby Joe Edmonds. Edmonds getting away. Gossett was blocked. Edmonds actually was tripped up and then got up. Jeff Gossett got a piece of him. A 36-yard punt and a 54-yard return by Edmonds, who has led the AFC the past 2 years in punt returns.
Well, the Oilers didn't get downfield to cover this. As you said, Seahawks were going to try and block the punt. The Oilers, on their formation, got so jumbled in and bunched in, they didn't get downfield, and Edmonds just makes a wonderful return.
He went 54 yards, first down at the Houston 19. Houston 13, Seattle 7. Randall Morris now in the backfield. Morris on the handoff. Reaching out near the 15. Childress on the stop. Randall Morris, a four-year man from the University of Tennessee, handling it for the first time.
Now what the Seahawks have done is they've gone back to putting John L. Williams at fullback and Morris at halfback. The other combination of using Tony Burris and John L. wasn't working. But I see they've just put Burst back into the game. I'm not too sure they should do that. Heck, they were successful with this combination. Why change it?
Second and six at the 15. And Williams throwing. And it was dropped. Butler dropped it off the halfback option that succeeded. John L. Williams, which is something you rarely see the Seahawks do. They went for the unpredictable play.
That's right. We don't see many running backs that can pass the ball. But if he throws this thing now, if he gets it off a little earlier, then number 31, Donaldson, doesn't get over there to deflect the ball just slightly away from Butler. That was a, watch the ball. It's going to get deflected. Here's Butler. But Donaldson will deflect it just slightly to break up the play.
So he did get a piece of it. And a third down and six. At the 15, and the crowd here at the Astrodome is back into it. Greg throwing end zone. What a catch, but he's out of the end zone. It is incomplete. Darrell Turner was beyond the end line as he made the play against Brown and Boston. He is the big play man for the Seahawks.
Well, here you have to have both feet in bounds, and he never did get the right foot down in time. He certainly had Steve Brown beaten that time. Watch his right foot. It won't get down on the ground in time to count as a reception. His right foot. See that? He didn't quite touch the ground.
Seattle's Norm Johnson attempting a 33-yard field goal. He's had a solid season, 15 of 20 on the year. And Johnson connects. 13-10 the score with 3 minutes and 10 seconds remaining.
On the final play of the half, Tony Zendejas almost restored Houston's 6-point lead with a 52-yard field goal. It would have made him perfect on 3 attempts over 45 yards in the half, and he couldn't have been much closer. But the score at halftime remains Houston 13, Seattle 10.
She's done it again. She knows what she's doing. She's got Horse Sense. Horse Sense is published in weekly parts. There are lessons for beginners with easy-to-follow step-by-step instructions and lessons for more experienced riders with lots of advice on how to take care of a pony so that it stays well and happy. In fact, you'll find everything you want to know about horses and riding in Horse Sense. So start collecting it tomorrow.
One cruise line will fly you free to the Caribbean from your local airport. There you cruise around to exotic islands and will fly you home again free. Pick up the Royal Caribbean cruise brochure from your travel agent and fly free to paradise.
If you've never tried Stone's Ginger Wine and Scotch as a whiskey man, Stone's and Brandy. Stones and vodka. Stones ginger wine by itself, or with ice. Perhaps you've never tried a British winter. Stones ginger wine. It's what winter was invented for.
Esso Winter Diesel Plus will keep you moving at lower temperatures than any other diesel in Britain. Wouldn't you rather be a tiger?
To all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions on a sesame seed bun. To all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions on a sesame seed bun. To all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions on a sesame seed bun. At McDonald's, it's Big Mac time for you.
The second half is underway in the Houston Astrodome. Seattle trail by three, but have the ball.
Ten and a half to go, third quarter. Houston 13, Seattle 10. And the Seahawks with good field position. First down from the Houston 39. Play action. Craig with time. A great fake and able to complete. Al Smith made the stop off the six-yard pickup. Randall Morris coming out of the backfield. On the reception, it'll be a second down and four. So Chuck Cox is staying with Morris and Williams after he started the rookie for Middle Tennessee, Tony Burse. Butler is to the right and Largent left. Second and four. And it's Williams, who saw daylight for the first time and has a first down. Free safety Jeff Donaldson on the stop. John L. Williams ripping off 10 yards. First round draft pick out of Florida last year. John L. going for 10.
Well, this got to give some life to the Seahawks. It's the first time they've been able to break anything up the middle. And there's 31, Donaldson making the tackle. But this has got to kind of get the Seahawks going here emotionally. They've got to get some enthusiasm.
Down by only three, although they have not done it statistically. So hanging around and have a first down from the 23. Now to the other side, Morris. And that was snuffed out. Johnny Meads, the outside linebacker, on the tackle. There's Meads, a walk-on as a freshman at Nichols State in his fourth year in the NFL. He's played well, coming up with four sacks the last four games. Made it back last year for knee surgery. He and Lyles, the outside men, have been outstanding. With Grimsley and Smith inside. and of defense from the crowd. Second and 10 from the 23 in Houston territory. Craig throwing, incomplete. Intended for Williams out of the backfield. Lyles on the coverage.
Yeah, but the play was made by Grimsley, the linebacker, along with the other linebacker. I didn't get his number, but they forced Craig to throw that ball early. Craig, had he thrown an accurate pass, however, Big John L. would have been able to gain some good yardage that time. His quarterbacks are not throwing the ball accurately today.
Grimsley goes to the sideline. He's been playing hurt. Injured ankle. Third down. 10 from the Houston 23. And now Gray going long. The pass intended for Darrell Turner, the big play man for the Seahawks.
What I tell you, when a quarterback misses a receiver and it's wide open, you have to just really be angry with yourself. I know Craig doesn't feel good about this. That's two plays in a row he's missed an open receiver. Now, how do you think Craig feels about it? That ought to tell you something. He just missed 6 points because Turner was open behind Steve Brown.
And the Seahawks, with a 4th and 10, will go for the 41-yard field goal. Norm Johnson, who hit from 33 earlier. He's 16 for 21 for the year. And he has tied the game at 13. Norm Johnson from 41 yards away. 8:23 to go in this third quarter.
On the Oilers' next drive, rookie running back Alonzo Highsmith picked up a slight knee injury when his leg slipped out from under him. So now Ray Wallace is in the game to replace him.
Oilers first down from their 47, 6:23 remaining. Third quarter. Seahawks and Oilers tied at 13. Rozier coming back the other way. Well, he got away with that once on the touchdown run, but Eugene Robinson stayed right with him, and the end result, a loss of 8 yards. From the Astrodome in Houston, Texas, the AFC Wild Card game, Seattle and Houston tied at 13. Marv Albert with Joe Namath. 5.5 to go in the third quarter. And the Oilers now 2nd and 18, back at their 39. Moon again got the tie and completed right at the first down marker to Willie Drury. David Hollis, the extra defensive back on the stop, a 19-yard pass play for a Houston first down.
Well, what happens? The Oilers flood that left side of the field. Everyone goes over there and then divides, and all Drury does is run straight down the field and stop. He just had a pattern where he ran straight ahead and just stopped.
Third catch of the day for the 5'7" Drury. The report on Alonzo Highsmith, bruised knee, and he will be back. First down at the Seattle 42-yard line. Again, the completion, this time Ernest Gibbons for a Houston first down. 17 yards on the play, and Warren Moon looking sharp. Ernest Gibbons is hurt.
Oh, he took a hard hit there from Jenkins, the cornerback. A good clean hit. Gibbons just goes downfield, breaks inside of Jenkins. The thing that makes the play is the pass protection. But you'll see Jenkins coming to your view from the left side and really rock him here, kind of bend him out of shape a little bit. Marv Gibbons has been bothered by the bruised ribs all season, and it looked as though he got a direct hit on him. They can't afford to lose Hill or Gibbons. Gibbons has to leave the game now, but if he can't get back in there, that will really hurt the Oilers offense.
Now Hill has split to the left side and Drury on the right. Moon is 13 for 19 as a first down at the Seattle 26. And the long count. Wallace off the slant for 4 yards. Ray Wallace replacing Alonzo Highsmith. A couple of plays back. Tackle made by Jeff Bryant. And here's Highsmith checking back in for the second and seven down at the Seattle 23. Highsmith hurt his knee following that 16-yard run. Alonzo Highsmith, who last week ran for 61 yards against Cincinnati, and as you just saw, having another outstanding day. 3:15 left, third quarter. Look at the time, and then Moon is hit from behind. Did not see Jeff Bryant coming from his left. So the second sack of the day for the Seahawks.
Number 77, Jeff Bryant, gets by Munchak, number 63, here at the top of the screen. You see him with a nice reverse pivot and getting inside. I don't know how Moon was able to hold on to that ball. That was a terrific job by Moon, not fumbling.
Lost six on the play. Jeff Bryant had four sacks during the regular season. He had a big playoff game against the Raiders back in the 83 AFC Championship game, recovering two fumbles. Bryant with the sack, so it's a third and 14 at the Seattle 29. Low snap. And Moon going end zone. Touchdown. Lenny Drury. A 29-yard touchdown pass play. And the Houston Oilers take a 19-13 lead. Zendejas makes it 20-13.
Moon, first of all, with a nice catch of a low-and-away snap. Now, hey, luck does help here. You watch Melvin Jenkins, 24. He's back there, but the ball's inside of him, and Drury just adjusts nicely to the pass with a touchdown.
An easy catch for Willie Drury, and the Oilers held their lead until the end of the third period. So the teams go into the final quarter, separated by just one touchdown.
Years in New York,
and he thinks he can tell us how to run things.
Well, we won't have it.
It's all right. I've fixed things. He's traveling overnight on the red eye. He had no choice.
Not first class.
Of course not. Company policy.
By the time he gets in, he'll be exhausted.
And he won't have had time to incorporate those new figures I sent him in his report.
He'll be hungry and tired.
I've arranged for the chauffeur to bring him straight here, not to the hotel.
Like a lamb to the slaughter, gentlemen.
Good morning.
New Club World delivers the businessman ready to do business.
Pleasant trip.
Yes, thank you.
New Club World from the world's favorite airline.
About this bill.
It's not the parts, it's the labor, see. Have you any idea how long it takes?
No. But I know a man who does.
So, it's two cars welded together.
Three? Actually, Ron.
And as we've got all your money, can you afford to take us to court? No, but I know a man who can.
Can you fix it?
Not this time. But I know a man who can.
Well, do you know how to get Gerald to Chester without going under any low bridges?
No, but I know a man who does.
Whatever your motoring problem, you'll find the answer is joining the AA. The AA, we're all you need to know.
Are you the man who can?
Hey, most certainly.
This is very nice of you.
He's a very nice man.
You're a very nice man.
Oh, my dear.
You're a very nice man. A very, very nice man.
No, very nice.
A very,
man.
Very
With 9.5 minutes gone in the final quarter, Houston have possession and are looking to build on their 7-point lead and finally put away the Seahawks.
Third down and 7 from the Seattle 48, 5.5 remaining, fourth quarter. Low snap again. And Moon off the recovery. Able to hit Drew Hill. With a clutch first down to keep the attack alive. 14-yard pass play.
A couple of fine catches on that play. First of all, Ward Moon makes a good scoop with this bad snap. Look at this. Has to pick it up off the ground. Then he gets the ball out here to Gibbons. Or Hill, excuse me, who's beaten Patrick Hunter just by a step or so. But Moon's able to put the ball right there in the perfect spot.
And the fifth catch of the day for Hill. Gibbons has caught 6. Hill has caught 5. Drury has caught 3, including the touchdown. First down at the Seattle 38. 81 Gibbons in motion to the ground. Pickett is stopped by the outside linebacker, Bruce Schultz, who happens to be a native of Austin, Texas, and like Jacob Green and a couple of other Texans, had to round up the extra tickets for today's game.
Jacob Green's from here in Houston, by the way. We didn't talk about his lawn service
yet,
huh? Yes,
runs a landscaping business here in Houston.
Yes, the Green Brothers Dirt Yard.
Yes.
I like that.
And he bought 81 tickets for family and friends, but he says his personal record is 95 for one game. Moon completes. Pretty move by Gibbons, getting inside the 20. All right, Houston, first down, Fred Young on the tackle, but Gibbons went for 18.
Gibbons and Hill are so quick, so fast. If you don't hold these guys up at the line of scrimmage, they're going to be on top of the secondary quickly. The linebackers can't get deep enough to get involved in this play, consequently have a good completion for good yardage.
Ernest Gibbons in his second season out of Louisville, 53 catches during the regular campaign, has kept this drive alive. Clock running, we're approaching 3 minutes left, fourth quarter, first down at the 19 in Seattle territory. Back to the ground for Pickett. Pickett getting the playing time. Mike Rozier, sideline. He picked up 3 on the play. It'll be a 2nd and 7 at the 16.
Now, this is a time I would go conservative. I know Coach Glanville at the beginning of the game said he didn't want to be conservative. Here with a 7-point lead, you're milking the clock. Chance to put 3 on the board in a 10-point lead. Don't throw another pass right now.
2.5 left, fourth quarter. Iceman, the second back going through. But a flag down. Offside against Seattle.
Number 45, defense. Still second down.
The strong safety, Kenny Easley. call on the offside, although he is giving his interpretation.
Well, there on the bottom of your screen, you just see his head come into play. Ken Easley, number 45, a little too anxious on the blitz.
And Houston will have a second and one at the 10. That is only the third penalty called on Seattle. Houston with two. The Oilers continuing the domination. They've had the ball almost 40 minutes. The reaction from Brian Bosworth as he came off heated. Both teams do have three timeouts remaining.
This is why Bosworth had to leave the field. The officials did not like his equipment. You have to have the proper attire out there. Not the haircut, just the proper attire. And his jersey was ripped. His pads were coming through. And the official said, hey, go get your uniform fixed.
And try to locate another jersey for Bosworth. You could see it was all ripped. Looks like Clark Kent getting into the Superman outfit. Now, would it be interesting if Boz just happened to have a jersey with number 41 on it? Could they stop now if they can't find a 55?
It'd be 44.
I mean, 44, yeah, right.
He can put the 44 jersey on. Now, he wants to know where the jersey is. No Boz country, huh? Well, not today it hasn't been.
All right, another number for Brian Bosworth. Number 52.
They already have one of those number 52s on the roster, Mr. M.L. Johnson. I guess they just couldn't find another 55.
And now we're set to resume. 2:05 remaining, fourth quarter. Houston 2-1 from the Seattle 10. They lead the Seahawks 20-13. And Alan Pinkett stopped by Sam Merriman and lost the yard on the play. Now we get the 2-minute warning. Well, we have a 52A and a 52B. M.L. Johnson, a backup linebacker with number 52. They did not have an extra 55 when Ryan Bosworth needed a new jersey. They happen to have another jersey with number 52. Warren Moon calling to quiet. 42. And Highsmith comes inside. Good to tackle, but he is stopped short of the first down, and it is Bosworth coming up with his 10th tackle of the day.
And alertly, Seattle calls a quick timeout. They didn't waste any time there.
Tony Zendejas, three-year man from Nevada, Reno, has hit from 47, from 49, missed from 52, and being called upon right here. This fourth down and three from the 12. He'll kick it from just inside the 20. A 29-yard attempt. Gossett putting it down. He missed the big one. It would have provided a 10-point lead. Zendejas, who hit from long range, not able to hit from 29, and Seattle very much alive with a minute and 47 remaining.
The second time he's hit the upright. The last time, the one he missed earlier, he hit the right upright. Now he hits the left upright. I don't think I've ever seen a kicker hit each upright in the course of the game. Certainly gives new life to the Seattle Seahawks, only down by 7 points.
That's an ugly sound to a field goal kicker.
An uncharacteristic miss by Tony Zendejas, and that gives Seattle a real chance. Now with 1 minute 36 remaining, they have a 3rd and 10 on their own 20, with Jerry Glanville anxiously looking on.
Chuck Knox, in his fifth season with the Seahawks, the only head coach in the NFL to lead three different teams to postseason play. Also did it with the Rams and the Bills. 3rd and 10. Tremendous pressure by the Houston defense. And the fourth down play coming up with a minute and 32 remaining in this fourth quarter.
Well, even if the receivers had dropped the passes that they or caught the passes that they dropped, the statistics would still be bad for Dave Craig today. But you have to credit that Houston defense for putting the pressure on and making some outstanding plays and pass coverage.
In particular, the work on Steve Larkin, who caught too early and has caught only one since the opening minutes. Three catches for Larkin as Craig, on fourth down, has the season on the line for the Seahawks. And completes close to the first down. Larkin right up the marker. Stopped by Keith Bostic, and he did pick it up. So Largent with his fourth catch and a clutch pass and reception. Seahawks maintain possession. First down at their 30. The clock is running. Seahawks have one timeout left. Now Craig going deep. And it was, let's see, did he hold on? Domingo Bryant not able to hold on. The pass intended for Ray Butler. Domingo Bryant, a replacement player, extra defensive back, first year man from Texas A&M, had a crack at it.
Bryant covers a lot of ground coming from the center field position. He should have the interception. He just drops it. It goes right through his arms, through the bread basket, and incomplete pass gives Seattle another chance to get on the board.
Chuck Knox looking at a second and 10 from the 30. Craig only 12 for 30. That's 40%. And has Larkin in the open. So Largent gets out of bounds to stop the clock at 25-yard play. Donaldson on the coverage. 48 seconds remaining in the fourth quarter.
Largent putting one of his good moves down. Fakes inside, gets back outside, and wisely gets the yardage and out of bounds, too, to stop the clock. Seahawks with one timeout left here, Mar, but they still have 48 seconds. Plenty of time to get a touchdown.
They need seven to tie the game. First down at the Houston 44. Craig took a pounding. And that's why that pass went short. He was belted.
He got belted, and Largent got knocked to the ground by Steve Brown, and we didn't have a receiver in the area. What's Steve Brown, 24, and Largent, number 80? Larger trying to get back outside, and he's pushed to the ground smartly by Brown. No flag, so it's a good play.
Second and 10 for the Seahawks from the Houston 44. 43 seconds remaining in regulation. Oilers revving up the crowd. Craig going deep, overthrowing Darryl Turner. Keith Bostic, the strong safety with Turner. And we are down to 37 seconds and a third down and 10. The Seattle Seahawks down to their final plays of the season. A season that saw the Seahawks go 9-6, second in the AFC West. Beaten by Kansas City last week to wipe out the home field advantage. Up and down club after beating the Bears and the Broncos, they lose to Kansas City. Previously, they lost to the Steelers and the Raiders, a very difficult club to figure. And Craig lofts it up there for Butler. He's got him! Ray Butler stops the clock with 31 seconds remaining in regulation. Butler makes the catch, although covered by McMillan and Bryant, and he went 32 yards, so it's a first down for Seattle at the Houston 12.
Good time, good protection for Craig, and he puts the ball just where he needs to put it. I'm impressed with the number of plays that the Seahawks have been able to run. You think Craig's not happy this time, huh? They finally hit one of those long bombs. They've avoided throwing the ball over the middle, so they haven't wasted any time on the clock. That's why they have 31 seconds up there. Smart play selection by the Seahawks.
And this, the 10th play of the drive. 31 seconds left in regulation. Seahawks have won. Timeout remaining. Gray getting the time. End zone. Touchdown! Steve Largent on a 12-yard pass play. A dramatic drive by the Seahawks to move within 1 point. And it will come down to the extra point attempt by Norm Johnson, who has been perfect this season. So Largent, who had been quiet after the fast start, that's Steve's mother. Steve Largent, a one-time Houston Oiler, with his seventh catch of the day for 132 yards. And here is Johnson with 26 seconds remaining. He has it. The game is tied at 20. And Zendejas, you'll recall, missed the field goal that would have given the Oilers a 10-point lead. He missed from 29 yards away moments ago.
Well, with just short time left on the clock, Craig's able to get back there with good protection and go to the ace in the hole. This is the clutch. Mr. Clutch Man right here, Steve Largent.
Steve Largent's second touchdown of the game ties it up, and the Oilers chose to run out the final seconds and send it into overtime. That's coming up after the break.
She's done it again. She knows what she's doing. She's got Horse Sense. Horse Sense is published in weekly parts. There are lessons for beginners with easy-to-follow step-by-step instructions and lessons for more experienced riders with lots of advice on how to take care of a pony so that it stays well and happy. In fact, you'll find everything you want to know about horses and riding in Horse Sense. So start collecting it tomorrow.
Most suspension systems go right back to the horseless carriage with only one new direction, the Citroën BX. Smooth handling with tight control and braking for unexpected hazards. Go ahead. Test drive the Citroën BX. You'll never look back. Contour Plus with Lubristrip. Contour Plus glides the razor so it feels smoother while you shave and smoother after. The Gillette Contour Plus system. First we made it closer, now we've made it smoother.
With something this natural, would you add artificial colouring? Neither would we. Simple, not perfumed, not coloured, just kind.